My name is Luisa Bravo. I'm founding member and president of City Space Architecture, a non-profit cultural association based in Bologna, Italy. The title of my lecture is Stand Up for Public Space. This lecture is about public space and the relevance and importance of public space in our contemporary cities. I will start my lecture with the very definition of public space. We can say that public space in cities is a common good, meant to be open, inclusive and democratic, a right for everybody. In recent years, public space has been studied by many scholars from different disciplines. So nowadays, public space is a very challenging topic because it is related to many different disciplines and many different understandings about cities and societies. Several attempts recently were developed to define public space. We can refer to the Charter of Public Space that was developed in 2013 by the Italian Institute of Urbanism during the second biennial of public space, which takes place in Rome. Then, UN Habitat started to work with the Italian Institute of Urban Planners, and together they published the Global Public Space Toolkit, which is now available online, freely accessible. And now, at the Habitat 3 conference, there is an issue paper which is referring to public space. I'm an urban planner and designer, so for me, public space matters. But what about other scholars and other disciplines? Why planning matters and why public space matters? We all know that today 54% of the world population lives in urban areas, and in the future this percentage will increase so that most of the people on this planet will live in urban areas by 2050. So if we consider public space as places for people to live, for people to meet, for people to sit and talk, we are referring to the public dimension of the city. And in this case, the role of sociologists and anthropologists is crucial to understand the relevance and importance of public space also for urban planners and architects. So if you are asking yourself, who are the public? The answer is you and me, we are the public. So when we are addressing public space, actually, we are addressing our own dimension of everyday life. But what about publicness? What about public spaces in our contemporary cities? In the research and academia discourse, we are often referring to exempla from the so-called Global West or Global North, thus imposing an oversimplified view of public space design, management and use. We can consider several public spaces around the world, and most of us are used to have in their own mental representation of public spaces images like those ones that I'm now showing you. We are referring to places where people live their everyday existence while moving from one place to another in the city. But those exempla are just giving us the idea of richness and identity and diversity, which are part of public space, of course, but they are mostly referred to the Global West and Global North, so with a positive accent on them. But what if we consider public spaces also as places of inequalities, contradictions, and conflicts? Those images that we are used to consider when we talk about public space then become images of poverty, of conflicts, of protests, of people gathering to reclaim public spaces, to reclaim their own cities, fighting against economic crisis, fighting against political corruption, fighting against the established government that is superimposing its vision to them. And we all know very recently several very well-known movements around the world, like the Umbrella Movement in Hong Kong, were establishing a new era of boldness and civic engagement of people in public spaces. Some scholars nowadays are questioning who owns our cities. And from the planning point of view, we could say that we have different levels to consider. We have the government, national and regional and local governments that are supposed to work on the design, management and use of public space. We then have designers, architects and urban planners who are working with the governments to deliver to the city healthy and successful public spaces. Then we have communities that are supposed to live in those designed public spaces. So the question is, who owns the city, the government, the architects, or the communities? Some are answering to this question by saying, we, as the public, own the city. Nowadays, cities are experiencing globalization trends which are dealing with privatizations of public space. So many are asking, what if public space is private? What if public space doesn't belong to the public sphere anymore? So how can we address this issue as local governments, as architects and designers, and as communities? So what can we do together? Because this is the question. Can we work together, or are we supposed just to maintain the public space as local governments, design the public space as architects, and use the public space as communities? If we are referring to the public dimension of the city, then we are referring to the society, we are referring to the culture, we are referring to human beings. And human beings have needs and desires. So how can we design to fulfill needs and desires? How can we measure aspirations of communities? And this is the question. How we as architects, urban planners and local governments be able to address those needs and desires and to work together with communities to create successful public spaces? If we refer to the public dimension, we have to consider how people consider public spaces in their own everyday life. Recently, some attempts were developed to show how communities are able, without working with local governments, without having approved projects designed by architects and urban planners, how they are managing to create successful public spaces. And those actions, sometimes of civil disobedience, are actually derived from spontaneous interventions that communities are creating by their own in the public space, sometimes to adapt to their needs, sometimes to create some beauty moments of public life in their own neighborhoods, sometimes to provide those needs and desires that governments and architects and urban planners are not able to provide. In 2012, at the Venice Architecture Biennale, the American Pavilion presented spontaneous intervention. More than 120 projects were delivering a clear image of how communities can be successful in creating their own public spaces. And recently, at the Venice Architecture Biennale, curated by Alejandro Aravena, Aravena is addressing architecture as giving form to the places where people live. So it seems that Aravena is addressing the social dimension of public space while being an architect. So the solution of this process is that all different actors, which means researchers, governments, planners, architects, and the communities are supposed to work together in the process of making the city, of shaping the city, of creating successful public spaces. But this is not as simple as it seems, because actually every context is different, so we can't deliver the same guidelines or rules that can be followed in different contexts, because every culture is different, every society is different, and so needs and desires are different. That's why we are supposed to be engaged in a process that has to be very complex, very long, very difficult, and so sometimes results are not necessarily beautiful architectures that most of the architects are asked to provide to the built environment. Sometimes very simple interventions in the public realm can be very successful because they can address the precise needs and desires that communities ask to governments and architects. So taking care of their own environment from the architecture side is something that has to be taken into serious consideration. So architecture can be the solution, of course, but even small in scale architecture intervention can be the solution as well. So we do not need big, successful, glittering solutions. Sometimes we need some very simple solutions, but which are able to address basic and sophisticated needs of communities. In the academic environment, as teachers, we are required to teach our students how to design cities, how to design public spaces, and we usually give our students some very good references and case studies that they can consider to design their own public spaces. But usually those designs are referred to successful celebrity architects. Of course, some of them are really very successful and we can mention some of them. But for this lecture, I don't want to mention any of them because public space is not a static concept. While it is a very dynamic concept which is related to society. Society is always changing, is an evolving, living concept. So public space has to be adapted in time to society, desires and needs. So what can be successful today maybe will not be successful in 10 years. As we said, public space is referring to the public dimension, is referring to society. So every one of us is contributing to the success of public space. So each one is able to do something every day to improve public space. Recently, UN Habitat launched several projects to create this awareness in populations and citizens about public space. The most famous one that was launched in 2012 at the World Urban Forum is I Am a City Changer. And this is specifically related to public space because, as we said, we are the public space. We as human beings, we as communities, we as citizens, we as people who take care of their own environment, people who take care about their own city, people who take care about their own public space. At the Habitat 3 conference, my non-profit organization, City Space Architecture, launched a global campaign which is called Stand Up for Public Space, in collaboration with several universities from Australia, China, New Zealand, and with a partner based in Ecuador. We want to spread awareness on the importance of public space in cities. The campaign is entitled Stand Up for Public Space. So we encourage anyone who is interested to contribute to create awareness on public space to work with us, to join the campaign, to be on our side, to deliver a powerful idea of public space in that process that links citizens to architects and planners and governments. Join our global campaign on our website, standupforpublicspace.org. Stand up for your right to the city. Stand up to reclaim your public good.